mom and dad made a commitment at a missions conference one time. They said they didn't really, they couldn't give their lives, but they could give the lives of their sons.
There once was a man born of high circumstance, heir to advantage, he had every chance to succeed.
I fought it when I was in high school. And I, you know, I didn't really think that that's what I wanted to do. I mean, I had a lot of other interests that didn't have anything to do with missions.
But light from the cross made his dreams appear small, and to their surprise, he went far from it all. For the love of his Savior, for one priceless jewel, they could not understand, so they
one of the strong influences in my life was the martyrdom of the five missionaries in Ecuador, because that happened when I was just 14 years old.
My dad just said, you know, that that was the reason that, that they had felt the call of the mission field.
I can remember that vividly, and, you know, hearing the news.
Their husbands were what made my parents want to be missionaries.
Knowing the wives of three of the five guys, knowing, you know, Rachel Saint and Dayuma, those were special times for us, and just a confirmation of God's early call on my life for missionary service.
There's no fool. He is no fool.
I went to Nyack Missionary College, and when Joyce and I started dating, we'd gone to a Bible conference. I can remember her going forward in one of the meetings, and she just said, well, Lord, you know, if you want me to be a missionary, I'm willing to give up Phil. Yeah, you know, it wasn't too long after that that just in conversation I had said to her, you know, I don't know how you feel about being a missionary, but I feel like that's what God's calling me to do.
One night the phone rang, I think, and it was the Alliance calling saying that they had an opening in the school in Ecuador.
Joyce's dad was a pastor, and I would go to him and I'd say, I'm going to take your daughter off to Ecuador. How do we know that this is what God's will is for our life? And he would say, when you actually get on the field and the times get tough, you need to be able to take God back to that place where you know he called you and say, God, I don't know why this is going on, but I know you called me. And this is your problem, not mine.
I do remember getting on the airplane and everybody crying and saying goodbye, and I couldn't understand why everybody was so sad.
When we first got there, all five of the wives were still working in that country. Elizabeth Elliott was still working in the jungles with the Indians at that time.
First year I was in the hospital more than I was out of the hospital. I had a congenital kidney ailment that had never shown up.
My dad's job was as a high school principal to start with. My mom was teaching kindergarten.
We were scared to death that the mission was going to send us home because I was so ill.
I loved living in Ecuador. I had so many experiences that kids my age had never heard of.
I can remember getting a bill from the hospital in Miami saying you owe X number of dollars and cents, and the next day a check coming in the mail for the exact amount, I mean the exact amount to the penny.
We got to do so many things. We went to the jungle, we went to the beach.
It just seemed kind of like a place that was home right off the bat.
One time, we were at the jungle. We were trying to jump off this 30-foot bridge into the river. And the river had a current, so as soon as you hit the water, you had to start swimming or you'd go downriver. My youngest brother, Matthew, he wanted to jump off of it so bad, but he was so afraid. So I went up there with him and I said, I'll jump with you. And he said, well, why don't you pray for me first before I jump? So I said, okay. So I said, dear Lord, help Matthew as he jumps, amen, and I pushed him. Dad called us all in the living room and we sat down and he said that he had received a letter from ACSI.
I was all excited about coming back to the United States, you know, being this great country.
And I remember being very angry at my parents and being very angry at God because all my friends were in Ecuador.
I look back now thinking, it really wasn't that great just to come rushing back to the United States.
He gave us each the opportunity to say, I'm not happy about this. I don't want to go.
I do remember the day we left.
I even begged to let them let me stay until I graduated from high school.
We had started climbing in, and we were all looking out the windows, the ones of us that were close to it.
It was hard watching them when we left. It was very emotional.
My dad started crying.
Watching my father cry as we left in the airplane and knew that his heart was always there.
It was one of the first times I can really remember him crying hard. So.
It was very emotional.
And I think he knew he wouldn't go back.
When I came to ACSI 21 years ago, I was just a green, young, dark-haired guy that really knew little about Christian schooling.
The first office was in the basement of our first home. When you came down the stairs from upstairs, it opened up into a big room, and there was a desk on the right side and a desk on the left side, and they both faced each other.
Dad would pick up the phone and intercom Mom and talk to her over the phone, but yet they were sitting right across the room from each other.
We used to think faxing was the greatest thing ever.
It was very small and became very crowded very quickly.
The one perk I do remember was they got a company car, so. Toyota Camry. It was much better than the four-door station wagon with wood paneling.
Slave labor and work was never done. After supper, they would always go back downstairs.
In a way, it kind of became a family thing.
I can remember certain folding project. It was a circle of the world and it had all the children around it holding hands, and he had to fold it into a perfect square.
I used to go down and help Mom stuff envelopes and lick them and get them all ready for the post office.
I remember probably folding 4,000 or 5,000 of them, and I think Dad tried to pay me a penny a piece.
I always felt like there was a little bit of a salesman job that we had to do to kind of validate our existence.
When it starts out with two people in the basement of a house in Northport, Alabama.
We thought maybe he might travel a couple places, go visit the office a couple times.
I never would have thought it would have lasted that long.
There maybe wasn't completely an understanding of how huge a frontier the rest of the world was for the Christian school movement. When I first came on board in 91, we had Stuart Salazar's office in Latin America.
Phil Renicks had a lot of vision, faith, or was a crazy man.
Phil and Joyce might describe it as it was really starting to take off and solidify.
Here we meet and we come up with this idea of having an regional office for Latin America, and he instantly made me regional director.
There was a guy in Alabama that donated a van, so I drove it through Mexico with the guy from the office down there. Bribed our way through both borders and everything else to get it there.
I was just 28 years old. How do you trust a regional office to a 28-year-old Bible teacher? He really took a big risk on taking me into the team.
ACSI, I think, was really beginning to realize this is a huge ministry opportunity through this international office.
When I first came into ACSI, it was a very different world than it is today. I never in my wildest dreams imagined that there would ever be an opportunity for ACSI to work with Christian school educators in countries of the world that had been closed off by a communist philosophy of education.
The man is a visionary. He's had a tremendous impact, and it's been sitting under the master and watching him make that vision become a reality.
He was very active in trying to find support in the early days. He was the development department for international ministries.
We could always count on Joyce to get us what we needed.
Joyce, she's the one that held the lifeline for those of us on the field.
I don't think it's possible that my dad could do what he does today without my mother.
I don't know what it is that makes him a successful package. I think the fact that she stands behind him 100% and he'll back her up 100%.
They just kind of read each other's minds. They know almost what the other person is thinking.
I think she just gives him strength that he needs when he's tired and when he gets frustrated.
Mom would be the one that would step in and say, okay, it's time to focus, it's time to calm down, you're going to be fine.
Joyce was always the go-to person if Phil wasn't around.
We sort of gave Phil the nickname of Uncle Phil because he was the one that really provided the funding for our office. I mean, completely, from soup to nuts, A to Z.
He understood that not everything can be done in the same time frame that things can be done necessarily in North America.
Phil was different, and I always felt that Phil is one of us.
He was more like a family. He was more kind of a mentor, so involved in the work that he really was like an uncle to us.
When I was a high school principal, you know, I shared with Phil my concerns and my difficulties, and his advice was so wise.
Just knowing that Phil understood made the difference in our work.
In 1991, I was with him at the first ACSI convention in Timișoara, Romania.
When I got into Romania, people were so hungry for the gospel. Everybody wanted a Bible.
He came to our conferences, and I said, oh, what a treasure God placed in him.
I've really appreciated Joyce, and I first met her in Timișoara, Romania, when their son Matthew came to this conference.
The year that they had the big conference in Romania, I was able to be a part of that.
I thought to myself, what a wonderful privilege it was for their youngest son to be there.
To see him, to have the heart to help those people, is amazing.
I thought to myself, how wonderful for the whole family to be involved in international ministries.
I think my grandfather instilled a lot of that in my father, which has instilled it in me and my brother as well.
I only have one brother. We went as missionaries to Ecuador. They went as missionaries to Brazil. And I thought about my parents and the huge sacrifice that they made. And having both of their sons and all their grandkids away from them for all of those years.
I absolutely know that there is a cost for the ministry that they have been involved in.
The cost of not being around our families, I mean our grandparents when we were younger and growing up.
The thing that's so wonderful about their relationship with the Lord and their relationship with each other is that you don't necessarily see that cost in their countenance.
He made a deal with his grandkids that when they turned 10, he would take them on one of his trips.
We've all been on a trip with my father, and now he's taking his grandchildren all on a trip.
It's been the pattern since the first grandchild arrived.
My sister's oldest has been to Guatemala, and her middle son has been to Austria.
When Michael hit the age of 10, you know, Phil and Joyce took him overseas.
My kids can't wait till they get to go. I mean, they're like, we're going to Africa, because that's where they want to go with their papa.
There's this idea of not just pouring into where he is, but letting the grandkids see a part of what God is doing around the world that Phil and Joyce have gotten to be involved in.
The legacy that my father is leaving, it's incredible. My children know the love that my father has for people all over the world. And when my children pray, they pray for those people because my father has taught them how to do that. My father has taught them to have that kind of love, and I could not ask for a better legacy for my children from my parents.
Our original sense of God's calling in our life was to Africa, not to Ecuador.
There is something special, I believe, that my father has about Africa.
Phil and Joy, they are my brothers and sister. I love them. They love me.
I saw this tall American man who just loved the people of South Africa.
With Phil, I think what I see in him, it's just, it all boils down to relationships.
His hand, when he touches me on my back, yeah, I feel it that, yes, it is that hand of love.
It doesn't matter if he's working with kids, if he's working with adults, or if he's working cross-culturally, or is intersecting within an office. He loves people.
There's this tender place in his heart. He loves the people, he loves the country.
I always love to see his tears.
Here in Africa, a person's story, the road that they've walked, is a very important element. Man, it's important.
I must tell you, what a privilege to work with such a man. He has got such a passion for children, and especially for African children.
He has such a burden for the children. He wants them to know God, and he wants them to have the gospel.
It certainly is a bittersweet moment. I've thoroughly enjoyed what I've done. I wouldn't even call this a job. This has just been a real privilege for me to serve in the capacity that I've served with ACSI. But the bitter part of it is every time I make a trip and every time I'm with these people that have become really part of my family, I think, is this the last time we'll see one another? It's tough. This has been my baby. I've nurtured it along from day one, started in the basement of my home, and now to see what God has done all over the world, it's terribly rewarding. I can't tell you how rewarding it is to recognize that here this little old farm boy from Ohio who had never hardly been outside of his own community, God has used all over the world to expand the role of Christian schooling and Christian education. And I thank God for that. It's been a privilege beyond anything that I could ever have imagined.
To see the international offices develop and the hundreds and hundreds of Christian schools rise up all over the world and then come into membership and to be served well.
One of the major reasons that I chose this job was because of his godly leadership.
When we travel internationally, he is viewed as a statesman.
When I go to Colorado now and look on the wall and see all of those regional offices in particular, I mean, they've added the Philippines, South Africa. I just can't, I mean, we weren't even in Africa in the mid-90s when I left.
Highly admired Phil's commitment to the work that God has called him into, to serving Christian schools on the international scene.
To see what God has done with him and to hear the stories of all the people that he's met is amazing.
Phil, it is time to say goodbye. This time came far too fast, but I need to let you know that the almost past 2 years that I had the opportunity to work with you closely has come as an incredible blessing in my life. And I am so aware of the fact that when I say goodbye to you, I say goodbye to Joyce as well. Because Phil, I know that you will be the first one to acknowledge that behind every successful man is an awesome, godly woman. And when I think of the two of you and the precious time that I had the opportunity to spend in your home, I am reminded of the awesome parents, but more important, the awesome grandparents that you are. You two have influenced my life in such a precious way, and I will forever thank our Father in Heaven for that.
Thank you very much, Phil and Joyce. You have given to me, you have invested into my life, and this is very precious.
He's got an amazing talent for making people feel special and for drawing out the best of people.
He's one of the shining stars.
We love you, Phil and Joyce. We'll miss you. Wahedi.
I don't think we have the words to thank him enough.
I realize that God needs to take somebody else now and to take the vision that I've had and run with that vision.
What we can say, we are not going to disappoint him. If the Lord can spare him to live long, he will witness the mushrooming and the growth and the strength and the witnessing of Christian schools in Africa. We love them. In Africa, saying to them what they brought to us, it's a good stuff.
It is an exclamation point on 22 years of ministry. It's the fulfillment of a dream.